Good morning and welcome to Revive. We're glad you're with us today. We're glad to be back after a week of vacation up north in Canada, where we took our son-in-law for the first time to Canada. He had many dreams for the little vacation we were on, and one of his dreams was to see a porcupine. He'd never seen a porcupine. And we showed him a porcupine dead on the side of the road. We got a picture with it, and he brought back a quill. Now he's dreaming of going hunting a moose in Canada, but we had a great time. Had a great feed of lobster as well.
So good to get away, and of course it was a highlight to Miles' family that they could meet Cody and the baby, but we're back home and there's no place like home, right?
Absolutely, no place like home. We're glad you're with us. If you're visiting for the first time, we've got a gift for you. It's a book that I wrote called The Champion Life. If you're here for the first time, fill out that Connect card in the seat in front of you, and we'll give you that book on the way out this morning.
In just a couple minutes, we're going to stand and we're going to say our Believer's Creed, because we'd love to declare our faith here at Revive, amen. But you know, this part of the service is always my very favorite. It's just before we enter into worship, and just before, and I get this little mini vision of us coming before the throne of God as one group of people. And I just see us moving forward and just saying, Father, we are about now, it's right this moment, about to focus completely and entirely on you. And that's how I want you to come before the Lord this morning. Stand to your feet just before we say the Believer's Creed. Father, I thank you for the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit that is already in this house this morning. Father, we ask that you would have complete and total control. Lord, for every person that is here, no matter the differences of their needs, God, that their need would be met today. Father, we're asking you that we would have an experience with you today, Lord Jesus. Father, as we let everything go that may be holding us back or hindering us in any way, and as one group of people, as the family of God, as we come into your presence, as we come and we say, Lord, here we are from Revive. We're the group from Revive, and we're here to adore you and to give you all of the praise and all of the worship that you so deserve, in Jesus' name. How many agree with that? Are you ready to march into his presence as one family? We are the family of God, so declare your faith with me this morning. Say, I am a believer. I believe in Almighty God the Father, the creator of all there is. In Jesus Christ the Lord, God's only Son, born of a virgin womb, I believe Christ died for me, returned to life, rose to heaven, and is coming back to earth again. I believe in the Holy Spirit and his power to help me be like Christ and do his work. I believe in the church, God's holy word, and all his promises to me of abundant and eternal life. I believe in the church, God's forever family. I am the righteousness of God in Christ because I am washed in the blood of the Lamb, filled with his Spirit, happy, holy, forgiven, and free. I am greatly blessed, highly favored, and deeply loved. I am a believer. Praise the Lord.
How sweet the sound, once lost, now found. Heaven came down, and grace rescued me. Hallelujah, I am free from my sin and penalty. At the cross you took my place, with your grace on top of grace.
on, somebody, give God praise that you're a child of God, that you're redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, that you're washed, you're cleansed, you're justified, and you're about to be glorified in His presence. If you have a need in your body this morning, God is greater. If you get pain in your body, God is greater. If you've got an emotional wound, God is greater. If there's sin in your life, God is greater. We're about to sing, God is greater. If you have a need for us to lay hands on you and pray for you and believe with you and bless you in the name of the Most High God, you come forward as we're worshiping God. Pastors and leaders and prayer warriors will pray over you and ask God's Holy Spirit to minister directly into your deepest needs. Sing it with us. Worship God. If you want prayer, just come down right now. God bless you.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we oh.
Help you run, lay it down.
All lesser things for greater gain. He is alive inside of me. I lay down all lesser things for greater gain. He is alive. Oh, Jesus, he took my
us. We thank you for that divine exchange. We thank you, God, that no matter what we do, You are always here to take us back. We can make a million mistakes, God, and you're never going to say, that's too bad. You can't come back. Lord, we thank you for everything that you have done for us. We thank you, God, that we have the strength to lay down what doesn't help us run, that you're giving us the strength to say goodbye to things that are hindering our walk with you. We thank you, Lord, for that peace that you give, God, even when we do mess up. Lord, we can come back to you. That grace is ever abounding, Lord Jesus. And we pray that on a day-to-day basis, every day, Lord, let us wake up. Let us hear your voice. Let us feel your peace, your presence, God. And let us feel that strength that helps us lay down all lesser things, God, all things that in light of eternity don't matter. Lord Jesus, help us lay those down every single day and be so grateful and thankful for your divine exchange, Jesus.
Night and day, let praises arise.
Father, we will have all eternity to exalt you. We will have time without time. We will have endings without beginnings, Lord. We will have all of eternity to exalt you. So this morning, Lord, we just tap into that eternal praise. We just enter into that eternal praise this morning, Lord. You are worthy of it all. All of our lives, all of our praise, Lord, all of our living, all of our stuff, Lord, all of our acquirements, Lord, all of our lives, we say you are worthy of it all, Lord. We want to humble ourselves before you this morning, Lord. We want to acknowledge your greatness, Lord. We want to say, Lord, we want our lives to exalt you. We want our work, our talk, our expressions, our conversation, our living, our dreaming. We want it to exalt you, Jesus. Would you sing it one more time? I exalt you, Lord. I live to exalt you. I lift you up, Jesus. I magnify your name, Jesus.
I exalt thee, O Lord.
Sing it one more time. I exalt you, Jesus.
I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee.
We do that this morning, Lord Jesus. We crown you as King. We crown you as Lord. And there's no one in second place, Lord. Father, we're not setting up degrees of kingdoms in our lives. We are saying you're the only Lord we serve. You're the only King we bow to. You're the only magistrate. You're the only potentate that deserves our worship. Somebody let a shout out, would you, right now? Somebody say hallelujah. Somebody say yes. Somebody say glory. Hallelujah to the King of Kings, to the Lord of Lords. Oh, I sense his presence here this morning, amen. I sense the very glory of God in this house of praise and worship. Before you're seated, turn and give somebody a hug or a handshake, a high five, a blessing. Tell them we're blessed to be with them in the presence of God this morning. Thank you, Megan and worship team, for helping us bless the name of the Lord in such a rich and powerful way. I missed worshiping with you last week. I miss it when I'm away from you, but it's always good to come home. No place like home. No pillow like your own pillow. Amen. No place like home. Giving changes things. Think about that for a moment. Giving changes things. Your giving changes things around you. First of all, your giving changes yourself. My giving changes me. Every time I give, I'm proving that at that moment I'm not selfish, I'm not greedy, I'm not stingy. I can give. Everybody understand that giving changes me, right? My giving changes me because I then become generous and big-hearted. Big-hearted. Whenever I give, I'm demonstrating that God is making me generous and big-hearted. But my giving changes lives that I bless through that giving. Every time you give, you're changing a life around you. My giving changes lives that I bless. Someone is fed because I gave. Someone is clothed because I gave. Think of this. Someone hears the gospel in the name of Jesus for the very first time because I give. It's amazing. Giving changes things. Giving changes me. Giving changes lives that I bless through my giving. And giving changes God's actions towards me. Doesn't change God's love for me. It doesn't change God's view of me. But it changes God's actions towards me. How many know that God loves a cheerful giver? God loves a cheerful giver. And the Bible says that God prospers
those who gives. God prospers those who gives. God multiplies the seed sowing. God loves you, but he cannot multiply seed that you don't put in the ground. Can't do it. He can't work with seeds that you don't give him. Giving changes things. We're coming to an offering right now. If you're watching online, you can give at reviveusa.net/give. reviveusa.net/give. You can give by texting 84321. You can send a check in the mail. You can drop by with cash, or you can give in this offering this morning, because giving changes things. Amen. Giving changes me. Giving changes lives that I bless and touch. And giving changes God's actions towards me. We're receiving your offering now. God bless you as we pray over your gift, over your seed and your offering. Father, use this offering to change. Change my heart, Lord. Grow my heart bigger, larger. Extend my heart, Lord, to more generosity and more blessing to those around me. Father, and change these lives, Lord. There's somebody that's coming by this church for help this week. Their life will be blessed and changed because I gave. Someone in Africa or China, Lord, is going to hear the gospel for the very first time next month or next year because I gave in this offering and we supported missions. And Lord, your actions towards my life are going to change. You're going to begin to prosper and open doors and give jobs and multiply, increase, Lord. You're going to open the windows of heaven and pour more blessing because you bless tithers and givers and sowers. And thank you for this in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen and amen. God bless you as you give in this house or online. And we thank you for it. And we bless you for it in the name of the Lord. God bless you as you give to God this morning. Hallelujah. I've been talking about this for the last few weeks, and there's nothing better for your memory and for your recollection than a little bit of repetition, a little bit of repeating. So let me remind you that we're building a church around this central, core, simple gospel message. Jesus has come to make you holy, healthy, and happy. Amen? Jesus has come to make you holy, healthy, and happy. In that order, it's so incredibly important. If you will think of people in your life, maybe yourself, the harder you work at making yourself happy first, the more miserable you become. Everybody around you that's caused you the most pain in your life, it's because they've decided, I've got to be happy. And the more a person decides, I've got to be happy, the more miserable they become. Isn't that amazing? It's because God hasn't designed us that way. It doesn't work. That's not how any of this works. You don't choose happiness first. You choose holiness first. Because if we're choosing happiness first, it always leads us to selfishness. I've got to be happy. It leads us to sin and destruction and hell. But if we'll choose holiness first, I've got to be holy. The only way I can be holy is making Jesus Christ my Lord. He paid for my sin. He can change my life and my heart. Jesus makes you holy. Then you begin to obey his precepts. You listen to his word. You listen to the Christian teaching. You obey what Jesus says, and you become healthy in relationships, in your body, mind, soul, and spirit, because you're doing what Jesus asked you to do, not living for yourself. And then you can't help but be happy, joyful, and blessed. So Jesus has come to make you holy, healthy, and happy in that order. Would you pray with me this morning? Father, we're about to open your word and your truth. We're about to take the next few moments, God, and say, teach me, Holy Spirit. Talk to me, God. Shape me, mold me, and make me into a person who understands and receives and transmits your blessing to the world around me. So, God, take these moments and grasp our attention, Lord. We bring every thought into the obedience of Christ so that we can obtain, receive, and embrace your truth that changes our lives. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I'm asking a question this morning. What in the world is going on? What in the world is going on? What in the world is going on? Seriously. I'll tell you, the hour is late. Time is short. Jesus could be coming very, very soon. So what are we about? Revive is invading the atmosphere. Can I get an amen? We are investing in spiritual awakening. We are involving the laborers in the harvest. We're investing in every technology to invoke the invitation, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Jesus has come to make you holy, healthy, and happy. Now, what are we talking about? Listen, Revive is invading the atmosphere. Every prayer meeting we have, every praise session we have, every worship time we have, every time we preach and we teach, we're invading the atmosphere. I hope you understand that. We're not just preaching to the people that are in this room. We're not just teaching the people that are watching them by internet. We're preaching into the heavenlies. We're invading the atmosphere. We're declaring the presence of God over this region. Somebody say, yes, Lord, help us to invade the atmosphere. And we are investing in spiritual awakening. We are prophesying and declaring a supernatural last days outpouring of the Holy Spirit like we have never seen on this planet. Can somebody say amen? And we are involving the laborers in the harvest. You've got to be involved in the harvest. You've got to become a partner. You've got to work with us. That's why we encourage you. Come this Thursday to our membership class. Thursday evening, become a member. Don't be just a spectator. And then take the maturity class. And then take the ministry class. Become equipped. Become prepared so that you can be involved as a laborer, a worker in the harvest. And we're investing every technology. We've got every tool at our disposal. It's amazing what you can do more by accident today than you could do on purpose 100 years ago. All of this so that we can invoke the invitation, so that we can spread the good news. World, it's time to come to Jesus. Now, we're using every tool at our disposal, and we will always tell the truth. We will always tell the truth, but we tell the truth in love. But even that will often be rejected. Let me tell you, I'm on my second suspension from Facebook. When did it happen? This week? Listen to this. The moment I posted yesterday about the Life Chain event happening across America, I was booted off Facebook again for suspicious activity. So that's why I encourage you. Don't just follow me on Facebook. Join me everywhere. Join me on LinkedIn, on Twitter, on WordPress blog, on my Instagram, and MeWe. I'm now on MeWe. Anybody else on MeWe? A few of you are, yes. Join me on all those platforms for when Facebook wants to slap my hand again. And I'm told by people who get slapped like this by Facebook that once it happens to you a few times, it's going to happen again eventually. By the way, God must be about to bless me big time, because the last time I was booted off Facebook, I got a call from Washington, D.C., and I'm going to Israel. Yeah. Hallelujah. All expenses paid. So join me this afternoon at 2 p.m. downtown in Collinsville here on Wycliffe Street. Yes, it is Wycliffe's, at 2 to 3 p.m. for some suspicious activity. Standing quietly, lovingly, prayerfully, and quietly protesting the Holocaust of the unborn in America. I tell you, weeping, grieved in my heart. Planned Parenthood has just announced the opening of one of their largest abortion mills in America to murder precious, innocent babies, to murder precious children right here in Fairview Heights, Illinois. So can you give an hour this afternoon to stand with me in prayer, holding a sign that says abortion is murder, another sign that says adoption is an option, another sign that says Jesus heals and forgives, hallelujah. So let me get to answering this question. What in the world is going on? What in the world is going on? Breaking news, it's not really breaking. Iran is getting closer and closer, they tell us, to developing a nuclear warhead. The Greek word here, I looked it up, the Greek word for the appropriate response to that news is duh. Yeah, of course they're going to. Israel is targeted in the crosshairs of nations around them, surrounded by enemies. Russia is within 6 years of having the majority of its military Muslim. England and other European nations now have no-go areas for non-Muslims. It's dangerous. You wouldn't want to go there if you're not a Muslim in England. The Muslim spirit is an antichrist spirit because, according to the Bible that we read, that which denies the Father has the Son, the Messiah, is the spirit of antichrist. I've read the Quran, folks. You can't fool me. What's going on in the world? Satan is angry. Satan is angry because he knows his time is short. That's what the Bible says. He's taken that anger out on men. Have you noticed? Men are now a target of the enemy's wrath. Masculinity is under attack. You need to watch a show that I do on Facebook when I'm on Facebook. Every Friday morning, 6:15 a.m. Over 4,000 views this week. Guys, you need to watch this show. It's called Manhood Matters. I post it on a page that I manage with 2.2 million followers. It's no wonder I'm a threat. Did you know that CNN, their biggest shows, only get 1.2 million viewers? And I'm on a page with 2.2 million followers. Somebody say glory to God. Yeah, we are a threat to the darkness. I talked in the show this week, Manhood Matters, about the fact that culture is now telling us there's really no such thing as male and female anymore. Mattel Barbie dolls, you remember Ken and Barbie? They're now creating, they're putting out for Christmas, transgender dolls that you can interchange depending on your mood, because that's the message we want to teach our boys and girls, that gender is meaningless and fluid and plastic and pliable. And if you feel like a boy today, you can be a boy. If you feel like a girl, it doesn't matter, because gender, male and female, doesn't exist anymore. This is a satanic attempt to distort and destroy the minds of young children. You think you know culture because you know the latest rap song? You better know where our culture is headed. You better know where the real war is. Portland, Oregon restrooms and all of their public buildings now. It's hilarious, but it makes you want to weep. Portland, Oregon now is saying that in all their public restrooms, they will no longer have urinals. They will no longer have urinals because they don't want to make it obvious that there is a difference, right? Because there's no such thing as male and female anymore. And if you go in a men's restroom, it's kind of obvious that the plumbing is different. Hello? I'm talking about the human plumbing is different. Hello? What? This is a hellish attack against the idea that men and women are different. A hellish attack against the reality of anatomy, science, biology, and the truth. Why is this such a battle for Satan? Because if Satan can destroy gender, if Satan can destroy manhood and masculinity, then he can destroy marriage and family, the church, government, and society, man. Don't apologize for being a man. Woman, thank God that you got a man. What in the world is going on? Trusted spiritual leaders falling prey to demonic deceptions in doctrine and in their personal lives. Evil men and seducers growing worse and worse according to the Bible. False prophets on every corner. Wars and rumors of wars. Immorality. Divorce in our pulpits. Immorality, homosexuality, pornography, abortion, sexual slavery is rampant and worldwide. Entertainment, your movies become more perverted and salacious by the hour. What in the world is going on? Let me tell you. Let me show you exactly what's going on. It's not a surprise to God. Prophecy is being fulfilled. Look at this amazing scripture in Isaiah 14. You got to read the whole Bible, church. I said, you got to read the whole Bible. It's amazing what you find. Isaiah 14, 26. This is the purpose. that is purposed against the whole earth. And this is the hand that is stretched out over all the nations. For the Lord of hosts, the Lord of armies has purposed. The Lord of the heaven's armies has purposed. And who can change his plans? The Lord of heaven's armies has spoken. And who can change his plans? His hand is stretched out. And who will turn it back? Oh, my word, this is powerful. The Lord of heaven's armies has spoken. And who can change his plans? His hand is stretched out, and who will turn it back? Let me tell you again that none of this surprises God. Jesus said, when these things begin to happen, look up. Your redemption is drawing nigh. Look up. It's getting closer to the return of Jesus. Now, we are living in the last days. And my Bible says, in the last days, I will pour out of my spirit on all the earth, on all flesh. In the last days, knowledge shall increase. And oh my goodness, it is increasing, multiplying. By every couple of months now, knowledge is increasing, doubling every couple of months. It's incredible. When God sealed his call on my life, 45 years ago, when God sealed his call on my life to preach the gospel to the ends of the earth 45 years ago, there were no personal computers. Think of it. There was no email. There was no internet. There was no social media, no Facebook, no Instagram, no Google, no Amazon, no cell phones, no texting. Years later, now, 2019, this church alone, we have in our possession tools to fulfill the next prophecy. The gospel shall be preached to the ends of the earth. Somebody say glory to God. So let me tell you again. Revive is invading the atmosphere. Right now, we're doing it. We're doing it right now. You don't see it.
Well, we're just not sitting here.
We are invading the atmosphere in the power of the Holy Spirit. We're doing God's work right now. We're pushing back the darkness. We're repelling the darkness. We're declaring the kingdom of God is coming to this earth. Somebody say amen. We're invading the atmosphere. We're investing in spiritual awakening. We're involving laborers in the harvest. We're investigating every technology to invoke the invitation. Come to Jesus. Revival is available, my friends. Spiritual awakening is possible. And it's inevitable. He promised. You see, he promised. The question is, will I be involved? Will I be in that wave? Or will I be looking at it from over there? He promised. We used to sing a song. We don't sing anymore. Maybe it's one we got to resurrect. God is moving by his Spirit, moving o'er all the earth, signs and wonders. When God moves, move, O God, in me. See, that's revival. Move, O Lord, in me. So what's my response to what in the world is going on? It's simply this. Cooperate with God. Pray, prophesy, and partner. Cooperate with God. Cooperate with God. What do you want me to do, God? What do you want me to say? What do you want me to give? How do you want me to respond? Cooperate with God. Pray, prophesy, and partner. I want you to look at one verse with me. Paul said to the believers in Philippians 1 verse 5, I thank God for your fellowship in the gospel. Isn't fellowship a beautiful word? I thank God for your fellowship in the gospel. But we really need to define what fellowship means. Because fellowship is not what we enjoyed over the pot blessing in the church dining hall. That's not fellowship. Fellowship is not a four-hour marathon of playing pit at the pastor's house where you laugh your silly side sore. Fellowship is not a rousing game of volleyball at the church Sunday school picnic. Fellowship is not even an all-night prayer meeting where you're calling down the glory of God over your needs, over your city, over your church, and over your family. Now, understand, fellowship may include any or all of that at particular times, but that's not the totality of fellowship that that Paul is talking about here. You can do all of that twice a week and miss what Paul is talking about. Miss what he was thanking the Philippians for. The best way to translate the word, the Greek word koinonia, that Paul used here. I thank God for your fellowship, your koinonia in the gospel. The best way to translate that to English for our understanding today is partnership. Everybody say partnership. Partnership. I thank God. That helps us understand. I thank God, Philippian church, for your partnership with me in the gospel. Now it makes more sense. Now we can understand what Philippians 4:19 is talking about. My God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus, because you gave, because you partnered with me in the task of spreading the gospel. Did you catch that? Did you see that? God will supply all of your needs. Everything you need, God in heaven will supply for you because you partnered with me in spreading the gospel. You want God to meet all your needs? Then partner with him in spreading the gospel. I say it again to you. Revive is invading the atmosphere, investing in spiritual awakening, involving laborers in the harvest, investigating every technology to invoke the invitation, come to Jesus. That's what we're about, church. Telling the world they can come to Jesus. So I'm asking you to partner with us. If you didn't give earlier in the offering, give now. If you're watching online and you appreciate this church and you appreciate our passion, then go online right now and partner with us. Send a partnership offering to reviveusa.net/give. Not because we're desperate, not because we have this great need, not because we're not paying our bills. We are. Somebody put your hands together and say, God is good and God is faithful. But because you need the blessing that comes from partnership. You need the blessing that comes from partnering with those who are spreading the gospel. Listen to me. I'm telling you, as your prophet, as your pastor, as the best friend you've never had, revival is coming. I said revival is coming. Spiritual awakening is coming. Psalm 85, verse 6. It's a prayer. Psalm 85, verse 6. Please, oh God, revive us again that your people may rejoice in you. That's a prayer. That's a heart cry. That's a desperation. Oh God, please revive us again. Send another refreshing. Send a spiritual awakening. We want to rejoice in you again, God. So let me very quickly give you 5 steps to spiritual awakening. 5 steps to spiritual awakening. Number one, spiritual awakening comes to those who believe it's possible. Spiritual awakening comes to those who believe it's possible. Now, if you're one of those who believe we've gone too far, we've lost too much, the world's too dark, you're serving a different God than I am. There's nothing impossible with God. There's no situation that's too dark for his light to pierce. So revival comes to those who believe it's possible. We've got to talk about it. We've got to preach about it. We've got to text about it. We've got to tweet about it. We've got to be obsessed with it. Revival has come, and expect revival because it's possible. But understand this, spiritual awakening only comes to those who pray for it. You know, you pray for what you need. You pray for what you hunger for. You pray for what you desire for. In fact, the word prayer, one of the definitions of prayer, one of the dictionary definitions of prayer from the Middle Ages is desire. Desire. Your prayer is your desire. And you're going to God for that desire. That's why you pray to God, because he's the only one who can answer that desire or that prayer. What are you praying for means what are you desiring? We're praying for revival. Can you say amen? We're desiring revival. There has never been in 2,000 years of church history, there's never been a great move of the Holy Spirit that was not based upon fervent intercession, prayer, and fasting. Never has happened. Never will. Thirdly, spiritual awakening comes to those who prepare for it. Those who get ready for it. How to get ready for revival? You get rid of all sin in your life. You get rid of all unforgiveness. You get rid of all disunity. Everybody say, help me, Lord. You want to prepare for revival? You really want God to do something supernatural to blow the doors off this house? And you get rid of all personal sin, all unforgiveness, and all disunity. Let me share with you a powerful Bible verse that's actually a rebuke to many of us. God says, without a vision, the people perish. Without a vision, the people perish. Oh, you gotta catch this. Without a vision, the people perish. How many visions? 12, 13, 94, 18, 7,000. No, without a vision, the people perish. You know what destroys ministry? You know what destroys revival? You know what destroys vision? Division. Catch this. Oh, this is good. Division destroys vision. What is division? It's division. Double vision. Someone else has a different vision. Double vision destroys vision. Division destroys vision. I'm slowing down because I want you to get this. Double vision creates distortion and confusion. If you've ever had double vision, it's like, right? It's just confusing. Whoa. You've got to get in unity with the leadership if you want the blessing that comes from the top. So you got to get in unity with the leadership if you want the blessing that comes from the top. Everybody say, God, help me to get rid of division. The only thing that's worse than double vision is triple vision or quadruple vision. Everybody having their own vision and nothing is accomplished. So spiritual awakening comes to those who prepare for it. Get rid of all sin, all unforgiveness, and all disunity. Make it right. Get right. Get right. Fourthly, spiritual awakening comes to those who offer God a personal pathway. Spiritual awakening comes to those who offer God a personal pathway. Thinking about this, and I believe the Holy Spirit reminded me that no one has ever experienced a personal revival by pointing their fingers at others and saying, oh God, touch him. Nobody ever got a personal revival by saying, oh God, she needs you now. God bless her. God help her. God fix her. No. It's me, O Lord. It's me, O Lord, standing in the need of your blessing. Standing in the need of your, it's me, God. I'm right here, Lord. It's me, God. I want to be the channel. I want to be the pathway. I want to be the vessel that you can use to pour out your spirit upon. God is looking for a channel, a vessel to pour his blessing upon. No revival ever comes unless somebody says, God, I'm in need of your presence. God, spiritual awakening comes to those who offer God a personal pathway. Fifthly, spiritual awakening comes to those who keep revival centered on the person of Christ, the Prince of Peace. Every single revival in history that got centered on a man or a woman eventually petered out, eventually lost fire. Because a humanity cannot sustain revival. Personality does not sustain revival. Revival that lasts, revival that's permanent, revival that's eternal, is based upon the person of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. Let me tell you how central Jesus is to revival. I love Psalm 85. Read the whole chapter. We started reading in verse 6, right? Revive us again so that your people may rejoice in you. Revive us again, Lord. Oh God, send your spirit. Send a spiritual awakening so that your people may rejoice in you. But go on to verse 10 and you see what revival really is. Psalm 85, verse 10, same chapter. Look at this. Revival comes and mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Mwah. Why is this so important? Mercy. In revival, mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. Wow. What an image. Catch this. When revival comes, there are no more warring camps between somebody who shows mercy and somebody who's standing for the truth. That's the opposite of revival, right? We don't have two sides anymore. One side saying, I'm for righteousness and standing for right. Another side saying, I'm for peace. Can't we all just get along? Why are you so judgmental? Why are you always talking about sin, right? No, the answer is in Jesus. You got to catch this. The answer is in Jesus. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed. See, John tells us that Moses brought the law. Moses brought the thou shalt and thou shalt not. But Jesus is full of grace and truth. Wow. Jesus is full of grace and truth. In Jesus, that's where righteousness and peace have kissed. Mercy and truth have met together. You've got to understand this, because wherever there's not revival, wherever there's no revival, there's always a camp that says, we got to stand for what is right and true. All this sin in the camp. And there's another side that says, oh, no, Jesus is all about mercy and love and grace. Don't ever talk about any of that stuff. Don't just love. We are family. We just love one another. Everything's good. Everything's fine. No, no. The world's going to hell, and you're all going to fry. You're all going to burn, you dirty devils. No, no, no. Everything's great. Just as love each other. How many know you can't have revival there? How many know there's no revival there, right? But in revival, mercy and truth, I'm trying to illustrate this. I wanted you to, somebody say amen if you're getting this. Mercy and truth have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed and made up. There's no more argument. Why? Because it's all centered in Jesus. And in Jesus, there's fullness of grace and truth. Jesus was able to meet a woman and say, neither do I condemn you, but go and sin no more. That is the fullness of grace and truth. Somebody say glory to God. No more truth and righteousness on this side and mercy and peace on the other. I want you to know God is going to do some unusual things. God is going to do some unusual things. You need to know that President Trump is spending more and more time with Christians. And every speech, he's talking more and more about God and faith. Isn't this what we've been praying for? Kanye West. Kanye West says he's no longer going to do any secular music. He's only going to sing and talk about Jesus. Did you hear this? Brad Pitt, you know? Brad Pitt is saying he's returning to the faith of his childhood. His mother and father were Baptist who turned charismatic and started talking in tongues. And he said, I'm going back to that. I've got to go back to Jesus. Somebody said, glory to God. Australia's most famous atheist, his name is Bill Hayden, 85 years of age, wrote books. He was going to be announced the Boy Scout leader of all of Australia, but he said, I can't do it because I don't believe in God and I can't take that oath to God. 85 years of age, he's returned to faith to God and says, I now believe Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. Listen to me. The end time revival, oh, this is a mistake we Pentecostals make. We want it to be just like it was in the 1940s. It's not going to be like that. God's not going to repeat himself. He's a creative God. It's going to be unusual. It's going to be supernatural. The end time revival will not be like anything we've ever seen before, but it is coming. It is coming. Don't you judge the way somebody else is coming to Christ. You pray for them. You pray for Brad Pitt. You pray for Kanye West. You pray that it's real and substantial and they grow in their faith. We will not be condemning judges who resist and quench the fire of the Holy Spirit. Do you know? I don't know what the history of this church is. I know a little bit. I don't know what you did with the hippies and the Jesus people movement back in the 60s. I don't know. Maybe some of you were them. Maybe you're here. I don't know. But a lot of churches rejected them because they were wearing jeans. They had long hair. They didn't look like the rest of them. Oh, God, help us. God, help us, Lord. Send them all. Send them all. Send the dirty. Send the smelly. Send the addicted. Send the lost. Send the broken. Send the wealthy. Send the up and outers. Send the down and outers, Lord. Send them all, Jesus. We will not be condemning judges who resist and quench the fire of the Holy Spirit. We will say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Pour out your Spirit, because you did not come to condemn the world. You came to save it. You were full of grace and truth. We'll have 600 people in this building Saturday night. I don't know why God didn't release Carmen to us 4 years ago, 5 years ago when we started asking him, but I know now's the time. I know now's the time. This place is going to be packed. You got to be here. Well, I didn't get a ticket. Talk to me. You got to be here. We need to pray for 200 salvations. We need to prepare for 200 salvations. Come Wednesday night, we're going to talk about that. We need to get ready for this church to grow by leaps and bounds by the end of this year. We need to prepare. If you've had no interest in end times prophecy, now would be a good time to develop a holy fascination. You cannot afford to not pay attention to the book of Revelation. Jesus is coming soon. He's coming again. We do not know precisely when. If anyone tells you they know precisely when, they're just trying to sell you a book. We know it could be at any moment. And there's not a single prophecy that must be fulfilled before the trumpet sounds. If anybody tells you differently, again, they're just trying to sell you a book. Our task is to live ready, to be ready, and to spread the word. We are ready for the greatest last day spiritual awakening this planet has ever experienced. I will pour out my Spirit in the last days upon all flesh. The question is this morning is, do you need Jesus? Has he made you holy by his precious blood? Has he washed you and cleansed you from your sins? In a moment, I'm going to invite you to come. If you need Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, you need him to wash you and cleanse you, make you a born-again man, a born-again woman, a born-again teenager. Online, you can do it watching even this morning. But I close with one powerful scripture before we invite you to pray with me at this altar. And I go back to this portion of scripture so often. I don't want to exaggerate, but probably 3 times a year I end a service with this scripture because it is so powerfully prophetic. It is such a heart prayer. It is such a word from heaven for our need today. And the closer we get to Jesus' return, maybe we'll be sharing the scripture every Sunday. I don't know, but I've got to tell you this morning, it's not on the screen, so listen closely. Isaiah 60 says, arise and shine. Church, believers, family of God, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth. Yes, it will. And deep darkness will cover the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. Listen to this. Look and see, for everyone is coming home. Your sons are coming from distant lands. Your little daughters will be carried home. Your eyes will shine, and your heart will thrill with joy. The sun shall no longer be your light by day, nor for brightness the moon shall give light to you. But the Lord will be to you an everlasting light, and your God your glory. For the Lord will be your everlasting light, and all the days of your mourning shall be ended. All the days of your weeping and your crying shall be ended. It's over, God says. I'm coming with joy and peace. Stand with me. All the days of your mourning shall be ended. That's revival. That's spiritual awakening. That's what we're asking God for. And I just have to obey the Holy Spirit. Anybody in this house who says, I need God to heal my brokenness in this spiritual awakening. I want the days of my mourning to be over. Because you've been weeping. You've been brokenhearted over people, over life, over pain, over problems, over issues, over burdens, concerns. You've been spending too many nights crying yourself to sleep. God says, I'm coming that your mourning may be ended. I'm coming to bring you joy in the morning. Would you come? I want to pray for you. I feel the anointing. I feel the presence of Jesus, the Messiah. We're going to sing it. You come. I want to pray for you. I want my mourning to be over.
Name above all names.
Jesus, Jesus.
Blessed Redeemer.
Oh, Jesus.
Emmanuel. The rescue for sinners.
Come on, get some guys to come and pray with me right now.
The rest.
the ransom from heaven.
Jesus Messiah.
Worship him.
You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and through you are all things. You deserve the glory.
You deserve the glory, Jesus.
You are worthy of it all.
Oh, come on, sing it to him. Jesus, you are worthy.
You are worthy of it all.
All my praise, Lord. All my worship. All my adoration. All my shout, Lord. All my faith. All my trust. All my belief, Lord. Sing it now. Jesus.
I exalt thee.
Sing it again. I exalt thee, Lord.
Oh, Lord.
I will exalt you, Jesus.
I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt. I exalt thee.
That's our prayer, Holy Spirit, that you'd be exalted in this house, that you'd be exalted in our worship, that you'd be exalted in our preaching, that your name would be high and lifted up over this region, Lord, through our lives, through our witness, through this concert on Saturday night, Lord, through our prayer gathering on Wednesday evening, Lord, we ask you that your name would be exalted. Not the name of this church, not the name of the preacher, not any one of our names, Lord. Thank you that you can do in a moment what we could never accomplish in 12 lifetimes. We're just asking you, Holy Spirit, to send your power. Send that greatest spiritual awakening we've ever experienced, Lord. Do it in a fresh way, Lord, so that you receive all the glory, all the praise. Now, God knows if you're preparing yourself. If you spend some time with the Lord tomorrow, or if really he never crosses your mind till next Sunday morning, that tells the tale, doesn't it? Of course it does. How many are saying, I'm preparing for spiritual awakening? I'm getting ready for God to invade my life, my family, my marriage, my ministry. You have a ministry, you know that, right? Yes, you do. There's people you're touching. People you know that I don't know. People who live next to you that I'll never live next to you. You have a ministry. God, you're invading my life. You're invading my home. You're invading my neighborhood. You're invading my ministry, Lord. You're invading my body to heal and strengthen me. You're invading my finances, Lord, to bless and meet my needs. You're invading my mind, Lord, to captivate my thoughts to the obedience of Christ. And you're coming in supernatural power. Go singing, I exalt you.
I exalt you.